pleasure to see you all here, and such a delight to be here with Joy and Jeff. And so remarkable to have the introduction that Darren just gave us, because it brought us into a world that is not only a world of technology, but that is a world of profound issues, or as you were saying here, a world in a period of speciation. It's kind of a crucial moment when things are changing, and the direction of change depends on us. We're not passive, we're also active in this change. So I wanted to ask you, first and foremost, how did this book come to be? There is a feeling of urgency about it, and I wanted to ask you where that urgency came from and when it happened.
He's sitting there.
You're sitting there, I know, it's always him. Hey, urgency, stand up.
So our mutual agent, John Brockman, had called me, and I had profiled Joey for Wired Magazine in 2002, I think, and John said, you know, would you like to co-author a book? And I said, I would not like to co-author a book. And I said, with who, just out of curiosity? And he said, with Joey Ito. And I said, I would very much like to talk to Joey about, because I had, and as people who know Joey know, Joey has a reputation, you know, a very positive one that extends wide. And that had been my experience just in the brief time profiling him, as having an interesting brain, but also having a social consciousness. And those are things I'm really interested in. And then we met.
And I think I met John before Max was even born, I think almost 30 years ago. And since then, I'd been promising to do a book with John. And so he said, well, maybe, I guess it was Max who said, maybe you should work with a professional writer. And I said, well, I don't want a ghostwriter, but if it's something that's collaborative, somebody who's actually smart, maybe we could do something that I wouldn't be able to do myself. And we met, and it sounded like a good idea at the time.
It's true.
And how was the collaboration? Because it must have been, there were some bumps. Come on.
I don't remember a single disagreement.
But what about the missing principle?
I mean, might have been a mistake. I'm not sure if it was a mistake.
Well, we put the cart in front of the
Chia,
horse.
Who's there? She was. Oh. She was actually one that made it actually work, because she was
very
the
much
researcher.
A third partner.
Okay.
So.
Because the missing principle, we'll get to it. But so the book is organized around 9 principles plus one, the one that's missing.
Yeah. But suffused throughout was
suffused throughout. Yeah. So, and just like Darren said, if you look at the page of content, it's almost like a way, you know, like a code for living today. You know? So I'm just going to read them for... How many of you have read the book sincerely? So I know, okay, a few. So the majority hasn't. So I'm going to tell you, I'm going to read you the page of content. So principle number one is emergence over authority. Principle number two is pull over push. Love this one. Principle number three, and we'll go deeper into it tonight, is compasses over maps. Number four is risk over safety. Number five is disobedience over compliance. Number six is practice over theory. Thank you, we have that over there. Number seven is diversity over ability. Number eight, resilience over strength. And number nine, systems over object. The missing principle is learning over education, and we'll get to that later on. So was it easy to get to these principles? What came first, the number of principles or the principles themselves?
I think
probably the principles.
Yeah. It was the principles?
Although we like the square. So originally it was a 3x3 square.
Yeah, because I know he likes to do diagrams. That's why I'm kind of asking.
And it was actually in preparation for faculty meeting where we were talking about the principles of the Media Lab, I had diversity over ability on there, but it was actually diversity over experts or something like that.
Yeah.
And Marvin Minsky nearly...
No, it was crowds over
crowds,
experts.
Crowds over experts. And I remember Marvin walked in, and he was like, I just want to make one change. And I said, what? And he says, it should be experts over crowds. Experts over crowds. And he didn't like that one. So we took that off. The idea was trying to get the faculty in the Media Lab to sort of have a conversation around what are our guiding principles. And I'll be honest, I mean, I think there were a number of these that the faculty didn't buy into 100%. Some people didn't like the practice over theory because they thought theory was really important. And I had, you know, when the general counsel of MIT came in, he kind of raised his eyebrows on risk over safety and disobedience over compliance. So these sort of were, they kind of average out to where the Media Lab is, but it was really kind of a great way to organize the book.
The idea of having principals started, so it was this one weekend we were going to decide to work together, and it was kind of just sat all day Saturday and Sunday, just the two of us up in the executive offices of the Media Lab. And I don't know if this predated the principals or not, but the thing I remember about that is that we both spent a lot of time meeting with organizations and, you know, everything from nonprofits to government agencies to corporations, and that I felt, and if memory serves, you did too, that it's like there were people that we thought were doing great work, even if that just meant like, you know, people in Fox Valley, Wisconsin making a living who were about to go into a buzzsaw. And this idea that, you know, that disruption isn't like, you know, like fun, witty party chatter in Palo Alto. Like it's actually people's, you know, real things, real people's livelihoods are at stake, people's pride, people's lives sometimes. And that the book, that there was actually a need that we needed to fill. And so it was actually called The Mission Statement was the working title for a while.
Yeah, it was The Mission Statement, Survival Guide to the Future or something like that. Yeah.
And it makes perfect sense because there is this sense of necessity and urgency. You know, being a design person, I always say the best design comes from a necessity, and it might be a necessity for lightness. It doesn't have to be serious all the time. But you feel the vector, you feel the pull, and so it's something that you feel in this book.
And I would say one of the things for me was there were all these books that described what was happening. The world was going into chaos, it was unpredictable, blah, blah, blah. But they never really left you with, so what you do about it, and especially for people who weren't in tech. And so the tricky part, when we called it the Survival Guide, you know, we wanted to make it not sound self-helpy, but a sort of rallying effort around the movement to sort of get people to sort of come together. And I also felt like it was sort of a counterbalance to the narrative that was going on in Palo Alto, which was we're both optimistic in a general way, but I think that in the East Coast, I think people tend to feel it's a little bit more complicated than the way that it's described by Ray Kurzweil and some of the other people.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Interesting, because you use three main nouns to describe the world as it is today. One is complexity, and then there's, asymmetry, and uncertainty. And I was thinking about it as I was preparing for today. I mean, of course, you wrote this book before November 9th, and of course, you wrote this book before January 20th.
The title turned out to be weirdly prescient.
Exactly. and it's really interesting because those three nouns are burning even brighter and more heating today. Yeah. And it's not only about technology. I mean, when Darren was speaking, he was talking about social justice that goes beyond any technology. But thinking of asymmetry, uncertainty, and complexity today is even more important.
I mean, Trump, you know, that was, that, you know, the whole debate in which Democrats always sound very self-satisfied of not having much advertising, not having yard signs, not having a good ground game, that was asymmetry. You know, I mean, Trump could have given the little lecture on asymmetry.
Yeah. I almost felt like Donald Trump had read our book.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
And Hillary didn't.
And we make that point, that's a problem with idea books that seem to be emanating out of Silicon Valley. It's like here are digital principles, and they're a good thing. And our point is like, no, they're just a neutral thing. It's just a new operating system. The new operating system isn't necessarily like some, you know, like inherently munificent or something. It's, you know, it can be used for good or ill, and, you know. Mm-hmm.
So you feel that he probably had this book and then Hillary didn't. That's fascinating.
I think he's an example of what we were talking about in the book. Yeah. And you know, to be specific, some of the things like being present, not compasses over maps, not having specific marching plans for everybody, pull over push, pull the resources as you see them from the network and be very agile instead of trying to come up with a single message and pushing it out. I mean, these are a lot of the things that he used very well in his campaigning, at least.
The problem is, though, he's not governing with, I mean, you know, I mean, one of this is maybe more my pet worry than yours, but is automation, and specifically, you know, the idea that self-driving vehicles could, you know, I mean, we're worried about coal. Coal employs under 200,000 people. I mean, in all the, like, support services and everything, not just the miners. But transportation is 7 million people. Now, not all of those, obviously, maybe not even the majority, would be, you know, put out of work by self-driving, you know, trucks, say. But, I mean, semis are just waiting for that. And, you know, self-driving cars are already far safer than humans. It's just that we have this zero tolerance thing that is holding that back. But as we get comfortable with them, I think that some, whether it's a universal basic income, I mean, we can't call it socialism because it's, you know, our Congress.
What? You can't call it socialism?
We can't. I mean, so, but we have to figure out how to develop the political will to not try to eradicate unemployment, but to embrace it. What else can people do that will give them pride and meaning that isn't necessarily a job? And, you know, maybe solve problems in their local community? I don't know. I don't have the answers. I just know that right now we're tacking in the opposite direction, which I feel that way about, mm-hmm. I think we both do, about education as well, often. Not all every school, but.
So let's talk about the missing principle. First of all, why is it missing? The missing principle is learning over education.
Because I suck. And
no, you don't suck. I just like tell the story. I mean, it's so much more fun to know the fight.
It was, okay, well, so the reason why Joey, I think, said like.
Because I know Joey loves that principle.
It is. It's a really important one. I never meant to, you know, it was, I mean, maybe even my most important one too. The reason why Joey said, you know, it sounded like a good idea at the time was I think we're both given to grand theorizing, and we it's hard to sit and talk to Joey and not be like, yeah, and then just like, you know, like an improv class. But the thing is improv classes should not lead to book ideas. You know, like, you don't want. And so it was very ambitious. It was like, you know, please buy our book about the world and how it's changing. And we spent like a good couple of years just doing a lot of interviews. I mean, I probably have like, God, so I mean, hours and hours of tape that didn't even get into the book, trying to figure out organizational ways, just the logistics, the raw mechanics of putting a book together. And it just had to, yeah. It was, because it was, learning over education is this story that if you read the book, you'll be like, oh, it is in there. Because, you know, we write about Mitch Resnick, and he has this amazing and, you know, long-lasting research group within the Media Lab called Lifelong Kindergarten. And I mean, like, amazing things have sprung out of there, including Scratch, which is teaching millions and millions of kids, you know, not just how to program, but how do computers think. And so the story wove in there, and it was like, well, which one, if we had to lose one, and we had to lose one. And
why
it was
did
like,
you have to lose one?
See, he's sounding guilty because he's the architect, because he was a professional writer.
Yeah.
The architect didn't figure out.
I understand why you had to lose one. I mean, if you were asking me, I would say, oh, I like number 9 better than number 10. But tell me.
I know, maybe because we needed not, I forget now. It was something pressing. It was.
But
yeah,
anyway.
I think it was none. Yeah, I don't know. It was.
But you're saying that it's an overarching,
yeah,
anyway, principle.
No, but I do mm-hmm. wish, I mean, I think for the paperback, I'd like to work it in. I mean, mm-hmm. it wouldn't be a huge edit.
Yeah, and now we have it in the slides. So.
Yeah.
What's your take on this missing principle?
On this missing principle? Well, I think we had put together an it was like Jeff said, it was very complicated architecture where we had these pillars, where we'd reframe it, we had stories that cut across that would be amplified in each of these pillars, or 9 pillars, mm-hmm. the stories were sort of falling into place.
Okay. And so, it was structural, really.
It was structured.
Okay.
You're an architect, you know how it
happens.
No, right?
I understand, but it's like I always, to me it's always about numbers, so
but
I can
talk.
Understand.
You have a great riff, talk about it, I mean, it's because it's...
Yeah,
it
I mean, well, I think it is my favorite principle. I think it's also very, I'm very biased because I think I don't know if it's a learning disability, but I was given nearly the same privileges as my sister, but she had straight A's, went to Harvard, magna cum laude, 2 PhDs, so it clearly wasn't the environment. But I got kicked out of kindergarten, I dropped out of college 3 times, and you know, really was never good at education. And so I always thought of education as the stuff that people try to do to you, and learning as a thing that you do for yourself. And so for me, education and learning were almost orthogonal because the last place I learned was in education. And so you know, I never felt that I was educated. Actually, I wasn't. You know, the only thing I learned in school that I remember to this day in sort of K through 12 is typing. That was really useful because it got me, I could talk faster on the internet.
I am,
you know?
So it's jealous actually
why
of people
you
who
walked
type
out
well.
Of, I think it was Tufts, is a great story. That, like, wasn't it like it's this physics problem and you were like, oh, I figured out a new way to do this, and the professor.
Yeah, well, I think it's around, a lot of it was around testing, you know, I just don't like being lectured at. I like having conversations, you know. And the thing was, the internet came at the perfect time. So 1984, I was in Japan. I was able to get onto the internet by getting into some computers that I wasn't supposed to get into. And then what would happen is you would get onto these university computers. In 1984, there were very few computers online. And then you could chat to the sysadmin and say, hey, I'm a high school student from Tokyo. And they would always give you an account. So I was already playing at MIT and poking around. And if you would write an email to a professor who had written a book about anything, they would almost always write you back and say, here, I'm a student. I just read your book. I'm in high school in Japan. My physics teacher's an idiot, and he thinks you said this and that. And then they'd write back, oh, he's wrong, da 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 da. And then I'd come in, and I'd say, well, no, but you're wrong. And he goes, who says? I said, well, the person who wrote the textbook we're using. And so that may be very unpopular, but maybe it emboldened me to realize that education wasn't working. But the internet really helped because it opened everything up. And then I just found that the college, and I don't blame the educational system, though. I think that if you have the patience and if you're tuned into that, it worked fine for my sister. And so, but for me, my sister actually got her PhD in anthropology and education. And so she was looking around after she got her two PhDs, and she looked over and saw her brother, who was the least educated person she knew, who somehow seemed to be sort of stumbling along. And so she said, okay, well, I'll study that, whatever
you
that is.
Her cause,
and
yes.
So she calls it interest-driven learning, and it's a thing. And so she started, how do people learn in informal networks and learning communities and things like that? And that's the focus of her work. But I think that what's interesting now with online tools and communities and everything, you can put together an education or if you have the passion to learn. And so my sister's thing, which we didn't talk about too much in the book because of nepotism issues, but I think
we actually talked about more in my first book, because even before this project started, I was deeply influenced by Mimi's work in interest-driven learning, and where it went into the crowdsourcing book.
And in a nutshell, which ties to the Ford video we just saw, is that today education and learning is really more of a social problem. So she wrote this great book called Hanging Out, Messing Around, Geeking Out, which is you hang around with people, and then you look over their shoulder, and then you start messing around, and then you geek out. And the reason why you have mostly white boys who code is they hang out with each other, they mess around, and they geek out. And the on-ramp to learning, so right now, if you get passionate about something, you can go onto YouTube, you can go onto Khan Academy, you can go break into the media lab like a lot of high school kids do, and you could learn. And it's just about whether you feel empowered to do it, whether you have the confidence to do it, whether you have access to the social network. So I do think that a lot of learning over education is the precursor to that is the passion and the idea that you have permission.
So that might be the precursor, well, or that you don't have permission but you want to do it. Mm-hmm. So it's the motivation,
right.
And that leads leads you to the disobedience part.
That's
so,
right.
One of the books that came out of the Media Lab, but years before I was there, but it's Sydney Papert's Mindstorms, which is like, ostensibly it's about Logo, the programming language, like kind of a manual to it, but like the whole first three or four chapters are, I found it like poetry, like this moving meditation on what it means, on the joy of learning. And he basically had this axiom of like, you should not teach math to anyone, unless to kids, unless it involves a soapbox racer. Which I just thought was like the perfect summation. Like, mm-hmm. if it is not a game, stop teaching it to them. Like, it's mm-hmm. that's education. Learning should be like, and I worry that with, you know, with automation, like people need to love getting new, like we should be teaching curiosity and skill, you know, the joy of it. Mm-hmm. And that'll be a, yeah.
Let's move into the disobedience principle, because all these different principles are very connected, which is pretty much the juice of the book. You know, so the disobedience principle, of course, it comes with a lot of examples, and there's plenty of great examples in history. But I would like to know how the teachers, the professors at the Media Lab found themselves and portrayed in these in these principles, and in particular in the disobedience one? I'm sure that quite a few of them.
I think disobedience was one of the few that I think I had no disagreement. I think
most, I'm sure, right?
You know, I think, and I often describe the Media Lab as being disobedience robust. It's a place where, you know, you can disagree and be disobedient, and it somehow still is okay. There's like and again, it's not necessarily the only way to do it. It's not necessarily the best way to do it. I know some departments where people are much more collegial and collaborative and helpful with each other. The Media Lab tries to do that, but not at the expense of feeling that all the students, and they have the not only the permission, but the encouragement to be disobedient. Because in a way, disobedience is how, again, I think innovation is an overused word, but whatever you use for sort of this kind of creativity, it's because the way I often describe it in a one-liner is you don't win a Nobel Prize by doing as you're told. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think so much of academia even has become political, where you know you sort of follow in the footsteps of your professor, and even if you have a different idea, I mean, the idea that you would try to turn your professor over or prove him or her wrong, it just doesn't seem like the right thing to do. And I think that the idea that the faculty encourage, a lot of people say it, I want you to tell me what you really think. You know, they don't really think that. And the Media Lab is peculiar in that, in fact, we do.
They really want, right? You really want to. Jeff, you're a journalist. And the relationship between journalism and disobedience these days has become really important, especially when it's disobedience to regimes that try to, like, suffocate journalism.
Yeah.
So.
Like ours.
Like ours, exactly. No, so I wanted to discuss about disobedience as activism, also in places that didn't think they would need to be.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, as it turns out, we all have different ideas about what a free press is, and I think that, you know, it's funny because I'm teaching a class that's basically, it's interpreting the day's news, but you could rename it Trump and the Free Press.
Oh, you could rename it Enemy of the People.
That would be better.
Yes.
It's interesting. Not everyone comes into even a journalism major associating a free press with dissent, a dissenting, or I mean, I don't know if it's exactly disobedience, but it's inculcated into us. Maybe it's through journalism school. I think mostly it's as vocations do inculcate their members. It's just through massive exposure to the practice and to other practitioners that your job is to afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted, which is actually a quote from, I think, C.E. Snow, I don't know, some newspaper man quite a long time ago. That's what helps, that we are the fourth check on, you know, in a system of balances, that we are supposed to be a check, that we're supposed to be oppositional. But it's not that Trump, I don't care that Trump doesn't disagree with that. I mean, I think we have a robust democracy. I think there'll be a lot of, you know, we are already putting up a fight, and I think that fight will continue. I care whether or not the country agrees with that idea. Because if the country, you know, agreed with it, if we're all behind that vision of what the media is supposed to be, we wouldn't have this problem. No politician, no one worried about popular opinion, even a dictator worried about, and they do worry about popular opinion, would dare to say enemy of the people. The worry is that some 30% of the country is going, hell yeah. That scares me.
The problem is journalism is not in the same state that it was the last time somebody took on the free press. And I think that
it's in a
weakened state. It's a weakened state from an attention perspective. It's in a weakened state from a trust perspective from the public.
Those are very
And true. It's also in a weakened business state.
Well, so, they're saying that there's been absolutely a revamping and
I'm on the board of the New York Times.
What did they tell you? It's going better, right?
I will admit that Trump's good for business.
Right. That's what
But the overall number of investigative journalists out there I used to be a hardcore blogger against the mainstream media. When we took down mainstream media, we thought that, you know, bloggers are going to take over. But it turns out, you know, if you don't have legal protection, if you don't have physical protection, if you don't have a paycheck, it's actually, I mean, you need the kind of tenacity and training that real journalists have. Yeah. And we haven't figured out a replacement for that, but it's diminishing in power. So my concern is it's not going to be as easy.
No, and I mean, I agree with there's a trust problem, there's a business problem. there's, I would argue, in many ways that have been cultured by, you know, if the journalism's problem was the internet, the journalism solution is, should be, and will be ultimately, you know, if not the internet, technology. And I mean, Trump has not just been good for business, he's been good for product. I mean, some of the stories mm-hmm. that the Times and the Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal, I mean, it's crazy because you will, you know, you'll see decline in quality if you flip two pages over. But some of the A-section leaders, the investigative pieces, mm-hmm. have been really sharp.
And the op-eds, the editorials also.
Yeah. Well, I think across the board, whether you're talking about student activists or the ACLU, just about anyone in this space of justice are fired up, right? Yeah. So lots, I mean, but even arts get better when you have difficult times. So in a sense, I think, you know, there's a lot to be fearful of, but one thing for sure is this is the time to really invest in those institutions that have kind of, you know, been sort of, you know, not energized because there was less to fight against.
Yeah.
No matter what, the feeling is that these are crucial and important times, and it's interesting because everything in your up and down before above and below the line of horizon there goes from kind of incisive and discrete into fluid and changing. Yeah. But the opinions are so pointed these days that in a way there's a very interesting perturbation in the system. And I would like to also open up the discussion because there are so many interesting, wonderful people in the audience that feel the same kind of change happening in their different professions. So I know who I would like to ask, but I'm always like, in Italy we say bringing water to my own mill. So I know that there are some design people there. Tony, Fiona, I see you. Can I call on you for a moment? I see Fiona. I don't know if Tony is also here. But I'm talking about, is also Tony here? Oh, it's Jamer. Hi. So Fiona Raby is a design educator. And I always start my lectures about the future of design with a slide that she's been using for ages that talks about how design used to be in the past and how it's going to be in the future. And there's a symmetry, parallelism to what you see in the principle. So it's about going from symmetrical to asymmetrical and from simplistic to complex. So I would like to ask you, Fiona, how do you see the world that you live in, the world of design and education, mirrored in these principles? Is there a mic already? Yeah. You have
there
a mic.
There is, there is.
I just put you in trouble, sorry.
I'm still thinking about it, actually. So it's difficult putting me on the spot. But obviously, I agree with lots of things, especially compasses, not maps. I think that's definitely something that we really value, and disobedience, taking risks. But I see those obviously within education, because I'm coming from an education. But, you know, I'm coming from London. I'm new here in New York, so I'm still learning about how education works here. But at the new school, I should ask Jamer, actually, because he's been here longer than me. So. Mm-hmm. Can I pass it on to you?
Oh God, thanks, Fiona. I'm just going to pass this down the line. No, Mike, I guess one question that I would just ask has to do with disobedience as a cultural phenomenon. And I'm always struck at the way that old people look nowadays. They have like jeans on and long hair and like cool beards and, you know, Chuck Taylor Converse sneakers on. And they don't look like old people that I grew up with. They look like Neil Young. And so I'm just curious about the way in which disobedience, which is, it has become kind of normative, that everybody wants to be disobedient. And in fact, if you ask most people, you know, kind of post-1960s, whether they would prefer to be in the camp of disobedient or obedient, they would all go to disobedient. And so I'm just sort of curious whether you find that, because I love the way you use it in terms of education, Joey, but I'm also curious of whether that can become sort of a false kind of mythos around what disobedience really looks like, and it just becomes a style rather than kind of a you know, structural resistance.
Well, I'm curious whether, and this is sort of a question too, is whether the style is not necessarily a bad thing to have, right? Because I think that, to me, the way that you change culture and change behavior is sometimes through style. And so if you read, like, you know, Stuart Brand's diary, which I didn't, but John Markoff did, and he told me about this, which is in the Stanford archives, it's all about all how fun it was to go hang out with the and do the marches, and it was about women and drugs, and but towards the end he goes into the Whole Earth Catalog and creating a revolution, and a lot of people get into these resistance movements through style. And I feel like whether it's Malcolm McLaren and the punk rock movement, sometimes there's a designer behind creating these movements. And I still hum Anarchy in the UK in the Shower, and it still has an impact on me. And it probably has driven my sort of affinity to this idea of disobedience. And I feel like whether we're talking about people changing their behavior for climate change to start feeling disgusted when things are, you know, in one way or another, I think that that may come through style. So I don't, I think, you know, there's sort of disobedience as an action, and people, like, for instance, and what's neat also is we wrote this book before the election. Now you have the Attorney General, you have the Department of Energy, people not giving out the names of the climate negotiators. You have disobedience coming out of the park rangers, right? So what's interesting is that I think that it is becoming a cultural thing to do, but I'm not sure that it's a bad thing.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. I mean, I think if what you are seeing, or what we're all seeing, because we're all seeing that, is a patina of disobedience over a new obedience. It's like, and that's what's become normative, is like, look, I'm being disobedient. Chuck Taylor's, you know, I'm a skate rat. But if it is, in fact, disobedience, which has become normative, awesome. Like, I mean, our book is, that's the point of having it as a principle. We're proposing that these become normative. And if people actually, they question more, and they are more inclined to, you know, poke at things and before reaching conclusions, then that's a good thing.
Mm-hmm. This lady over here, hold on, the mic is coming. Yes.
I'm a lawyer. Is there any place for us left in the world? Obedience.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I think all of your principles are my first, but in my law firm, I need people who respect the past, the rules, the predictability of a set of moral precepts that are in our laws. And I think I've always loved resistance and movements and marches. And I love the idea that science has been taken over by the disobedient. But where are we?
But I think, I'm going to mangle it, but I think Martin Luther King said it very well, where he said that just laws should be adhered to completely, but if you obey unjust laws, that's immoral to do that, and that it's our moral imperative to question all laws that we believe are unjust. And I think that what's important is I feel that one of the failures of Arab Spring was that they didn't have the rule of law to help them execute after these protests. And I think the great thing about America was that after the Civil Rights Movement, all of these, I mean, Marilyn Wright Edelman, I mean, they became lawyers to implement the changes that they were able to get going through these protests. And the law has always, in the US and in places where you have rule of law, reflected the norms of the day. And I think that one of the points about disobedience is, and when you're disobedient in science, you've got to win the argument. It can't be fake science. And just in the same way, I feel like the disobedience to law should not be breaking the law just to break the law, just like freedom isn't about free beer, it's about freedom. So I think that, again, all of these, and I'll say this as a disclaimer, all of these are meant to provoke a conversation. And it's not that we don't believe in compliance on certain things, it's not that we don't believe in education or that we don't believe in theory, but it's often the reverse. People say education over learning, the motions or compliance over disobedience, and I think the point is that you shouldn't comply with something that's unjust.
You should, you know, it's about criticality. It's about
questioning. And that's where the critical design
It's funny because this is, I mean, there probably has not been a moment in American history quite like this one to reinforce the fact that we are strong because we're a nation of laws. Like, you're never so thankful for a law than when it's the one tiny wisp reed keeping a tyrant between, you and your personal liberties. And it's not to say it's reached that point yet, but I mean, that will be what protects us, will be, the laws. That it's a nation of laws and not of personalities, not of mm-hmm. But I do think that the principles are more about a process of we're always evolving and adapting them to fit. But
and also as an immigrant, not yet even an immigrant, I am seeing right now how fragile laws are, how easy it is here in the United States to obliterate them. So lawyers are more important than ever because they become guardians of these laws and the philosophers of society. In this kind of situation, people that know the rules are and that know how to respect them and that understand respect are more important than ever. First over there, and then I'll come to you.
You got it.
And the ones in the back, if you can, okay, third. Thank you.
Thank you for doing this. If there's a zeroth law that we can kind of underwrite these things, it would be you're moving from centralization to decentralization. That's the underlying kind of philosophy of this. Are you seeing incentive systems that are being built to support decentralization? Because why would I follow this if there's no incentive system for me to get remunerators of some kind?
Yeah, I don't know if there's an incentive system per se, in that when I think of incentive system, there's natural incentives and then there's incentive systems that governments do. But the incentive system should be that you'll survive or that you'll win. I think in the short run, it depends on the timing too. I did this weird interview for in Spain, and they said, do you think that open will eventually take over Apple? I said, yeah, I think openness, Apple's great at innovation, but in the long run, a lot of the things that Apple makes will end up open. And the headline of El País newspaper the next day was, Ito says Apple is dead. And so I think there are a lot of short-term reasons why decentralization doesn't necessarily help you. So you gotta get the timing right. But I think in many of the systems that we're working with, whether you're talking about cryptocurrencies or you're talking about war, you just see this push towards decentralization just happening because of the technology. And you can either adapt and get ahead of it, or it just happens to you. I don't know.
No.
I agree with that. Systems was the one we were thinking of as the overarching, and that's why the principles are written in the order they are, because it sort of they do overlap a lot, but we thought of, that systems refers in a sense to all of them.
And actually it's interesting because systems also came up a lot when we were working together on Naughty Objects, mm-hmm. Which was a symposium that we did at MIT together with Jamer also about two plus years ago. And the idea of moving also in design from designing objects to designing system in general is incredibly important.
Mm-hmm. I have a question around push and pull with the media. We grew up in an era where it was push and it was Time Magazine and CBS Evening News, and now it's balkanized and it's free and half of it is fake. So given that, the distributed universe, how does this system emerge to create content that requires writers and editors and publishers and graphic artists and all that, which costs money in a world where information wants to be free?
Well, this is an old problem.
I have a thing I want to do next. I have a sort of a bugbear, and it's all about fake news. Like any right-thinking journalist, I'm obsessed with it and reading it and spending a lot of time in Trump world, which means I hear from, some people who with idiotic opinions, but some people that just seem that they are living on the other side of the mirror from us and can't understand what's wrong with us. And I think, how does pull solve a problem that, happened when push, began to greet obsolescence? And I think it's that you need to, if an army helped, wreck truth, you need an army to bring truth back. And I think there's an army out there. I mean, I think there are a lot of people, maybe millions of people, that can be deputized. And that's how crowdsourcing, so my initial research, my first work, sprung out of an article in Wired magazine that coined that term, crowdsourcing, and that's sort of what, the media has, in a sense, been crowdsourced. And the nuts and bolts of crowdsourcing is all about that deputization and how you incentivize them. But There are a lot of people who I think would be willing to do that if they could be convinced to meet in a middle and bring the truth with them. Because, you know, the thing is time left Ohio behind. Like, that's where I'm from. National media left these places behind. They put a lot more of their resources on foreign coverage for good reason, and often it still wasn't enough, and national stories. And I was one of the men. I left Ohio for New York because I wanted national media. I didn't want to stay and work for the Columbus Dispatch. But the problem was that people were not exposed necessarily to, you know, stuff wasn't marketed to them. So, of course, they didn't read it. They didn't pick up Glamour and Vogue or Time. And I think that if, yeah, that's why it's the next project, because I don't know what shape it takes yet. Mm-hmm. But I do think that there's a pull solution. It's how you deputize that army to bring truth back.
Interesting. There was over there. Yes. It's coming to you. Mm-hmm.
You talked about the prescient nature of how the reflection, the election was a reflection of Whiplash, not just in terms of the result, but what people may have been feeling that contributed to Trump's election. So, and that could be in part because government is not really introducing these principles. You know, the fundamental way in which government works is counter to many of these principles, in particular. There was risk and safety as being one of them, learning and education. So if, Joey, if you were a president and you were going to restructure things, how would you kind of restructure things, not just in the, like, investing more in education or what, in a more broad sense, but how would you rethink some of these principles and really kind of inculcate them into the structure of government?
So one thing I think is that...
So tight, so Joey.
Just about every institution that we have was designed before all this stuff. And so it's not even really just the leadership, it's just that they're not structured to be many of the things that we're saying here. So any new player who's smart will design their organization to be robust against a lot of these trends. And again, I think we're not saying that this is sort of morally correct, right? We're just saying this is where the world's going, and here's kind of how you have to figure out how to survive. The problem is some institutions just won't survive because they're not going to be able to turn around. So just sort of broadly, I think that's true. I think government is one of the hardest because it's got so many pieces, it's got so much structure. But and Megan Smith's back there, she was the CTO of the United States, and she and President Obama did a lot of really interesting hacks, and they're basically around entrepreneurship in different ways. So bringing Presidential Innovation Fellows in to do tours of duty inside of different pieces of government, empowering people in local governments to do all kinds of change, and her friend is hacking the UN by bringing, you know, new things in. So I think at the individual level, you can go in and hack these systems. And what's interesting, some of my friends were involved in the healthcare.gov, you know, like fix. But, you know, you had a lot of people looking over their shoulders saying, oh my gosh, this agile software development from Silicon Valley actually works on these big government systems. Boy, we didn't know that. And once you have that, most of the people in government actually are trying to do the right thing. And so once they get the confidence to start shifting things around, things are changing. And what's neat, having talked to the Presidential Innovation Fellows, which are these people who do these short-term tours of duty, they've been making massive changes in fundamental architecture that you won't see right away, but are starting to change things from inside. So I think it's about individuals and people rather than kind of like platitudes and big budgets, although budgets are helpful for some things. But I think, the money politicizes the distribution of energy probably more than it helps in many ways. So I do think, and the neat trend that again, I think Megan and her team before her started is there's this really interesting group of Silicon Valley and otherwise tech people who are now going into service like they would have gone into the Peace Corps in one generation. And they're going in and they're really spending, you know, going heads down trying to fix stuff. And I have a lot of faith that they'll have a positive impact. And even if you, whoever is in power, the sort of nuts and bolts of turning local governments into things that are more functional or fixing the nuts and bolts of a system that can't move around. Like, for instance, just the agile software development and making APIs for all the technology so that the data moves around, I mean, that will make the government much more nimble and able to change. So I'm pretty optimistic that there's a push that will keep moving a little bit. I hope, right, Megan?
So I think somebody already has a mic. And can I ask my guardian angels in the back, when you see that I'm going too long, just go like this so I know. Thank you. Go
for it. Hi, thank you. I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about diversity and ability, because of all the principles up there, I'm not quite clear on that one.
So it actually comes from... It actually comes from a math theorem advanced by a complex systems scholar and mathematician, Scott Page, and that was diversity trumps ability. And that came from a software project he worked on at Caltech when he was doing his PhD, I'm gonna try to do the really simplified version, but he set a bunch of agents, which are, little like computer programs, each one embodying essentially one of us, an individual. And they had to solve a hard problem. And if he made them all very, very good, but good in specific ways, they would be defeated again and again and again by sort of these randomized group of the same number of these little like artificial agents. And so he started mapping, and this is going back to like 2000. And so he started looking for places in society if he would find where groups that were diverse would trump groups that were very, very good, but in same ways. And he started finding it over and over again. And so the example I love, because it's just very powerful, is there's this thing called Innocentive. And Innocentive was started by Eli Lilly, but then was spun off. And any company can put a problem they have run their heads into and not been able to solve up on a bulletin board that are pretty much mostly, not all, but mostly scientific problems. And scientists from all around the world will look at these bulletin boards and see whether or not they can solve them. And what's amazing, that actually Kareem Lakhani, another scholar who has worked with Scott Page, found, was that there was actually, with successful solutions, it was more likely that the person knew less about the subject than more. You were more likely to solve a problem on Innocentive and collect the 40 grand bounty or whatever it was often lucrative, the less you knew about the discipline. The point being that when IBM decides that they want to hire 10 programmers who think differently, they hire from like Stanford instead of Carnegie Mellon. They're like, we have too many Carnegie Mellon people. Well, the people at Stanford used to teach at Carnegie Mellon, So we wind up replicating expertise in field after field after field. And, where I took it in this book, and it was very, Joey was very gracious, and I was very, passionate, was that, diversity shouldn't be this, we see it as this moral obligation, like it's the right thing to do to bring in diverse genders and races. It's like, no, one, it's the economically, it's the efficient thing to do. It's what you need to do. It's what journalism should have done when it was facing challenges, but unfortunately, because of last hired, first fired principles, we became less diverse in the face of, and so the amount of ideas that we had that could have helped us meet that challenge were bled out of the newsroom, and it's, yeah.
You are passionate.
I am, sorry. It was, you pushed my button.
It's all good.
I didn't know if anyone would, and someone did.
It's all good, Jeff.
So disruption and disobedience has taken on hero status. But my question is, it seems to me disobedience and systems are mutually contradictory. So disobedience is about sort of looking at the fabric and tearing it apart in new ways, perhaps. But then who's taking care of the fabric? We live in the fabric.
So let me take a shot at that. So when you have a system like the environment, if it's a good system, it's a self-adaptive complex system. And in a self-adaptive complex system, everything is sort of competing. There's all kinds of things going on. So if a species disappears, or if an important person in the community dies, the system adapts. And the system adapts because there's many points of view going on. And so in biology, it's usually the gene pool. In communities, there's different points of view. But whatever you want to call it, the way that systems adapt and become resilient is by having a stock of things that are different. And to me, disobedience isn't about trying to destroy the system. It's about saying the unpopular thing So Timothy Leary's used to always tell me, question authority and think for yourself. And to me, what happens if you don't question authority and everybody thinks like each other, you end up creating a very fragile system of monoculture. And what disobedience is really trying to do is tie to the diversity point of view, which is everybody should have their own point of view. You still need to have respect. You still need the social glue. The system needs to be internally consistent in some ways. And so that's why the reason the Media Lab can be disobedience robust is we all kind of believe in this idea and we have shared values. But within those shared values, you have... So disobedience doesn't mean going out and shooting your neighbor. Disobedience is being able to tell your parents what you really think and to be able to tell your professor what you really think. Absolutely. So it assumes core values, because if you don't, then disobedience is just pure destruction. And so that's why we didn't say, you know, destruction over compliance.
I have to take the last question. You don't want? Oh, you do want it. Okay, so go for it.
Thank you very much. I have not read the book yet, so I will. But I wanted to know what seeds can each of us plant in order to, like, in our own communities, to kind of follow these principles? Because I think this is like a grassroots effort more so than it's like, it's great that these people in Silicon Valley are doing, you know, big things, but it's like, what can each of us do? So, I mean, maybe you could just take one thing and answer it. I think learning and education is big for a lot of us. So I'm an instructor and I would love to hear what you had to say. Thank you.
You wanna go?
I think it's so individualized. I mean, I think there are a lot of things. Certainly, if you're an instructor, I'd say learning over education and disobedience could be really valuable. And I mean, one thing you could do, I think that we all need is optimism that we actually have the capacity to move past the, daunting set of challenges that we have now into a new age. I mean, I spent 4 months in New York 1815 in my head, researching to figure out what happened the last time there was this period of speciation, like this like bump where everything changed before a new period of stability was reached. And there was a lot of chaos, and then a new order formed. So I think that happens because more individuals do the right things than the individuals that do the wrong things. And I think that, every instructor who realizes that, STEM is here to stay, kids should be passionate about math and can make them passionate about learning is that's a seed, that's a big seed right there.
And for me, I've just noticed, I started a Facebook group where people are sharing, and you have people from the military, you have people from energy, all talking and saying, I actually have a story that works like this. And so I think, first of all, one is to sort of have a conversation. So for instance, if you're an instructor, I'd love for you to have a conversation with other teachers saying, what do you think about this learning over education idea? It seems dumb idea, bad idea, how could we think about it? Because one of the thing that's not in here, but that is true, especially in education, is that we tend to like things that we can measure. And it comes from sort of the economics, number-driven society we have now, that how can he be smart, he's not rich, kind of attitude. And even our educational system is based around, you need a job, you need credentials, you need to test, and we don't like what we can't measure. So passion, compassion, all these things that good teachers know that they have to teach their kids are not measured, are not reflected. And so if you start to think about the bigger question, I think, if you were president, if you were in charge of the educational system, and for a moment could step back and say, we don't really care about the system, we're looking for the outcome, the learning, how do we redesign it? And if everybody can kind of agree, and the teachers and the parents can all agree, I think there's a way to sort of change the system. And I think the problem is that the language that we use when we talk about education is defined by the educational system and the academics around what education is. And I think what we're trying to do is to say, no, you have to sort of step back and allow yourself to reframe the problem.
I fear that so many people in the room, however, already live by these principles in kind of, and so I find the question very interesting, because it's about how you make it happen also outside of your peeps, you know, of your peeps group. But I think, you know, just to close, that what Jeff said before, you know, this way of optimism, which I also would like to condense in the words trust and respect, is something that seems to be the way to diffuse these ideas. And maybe you can think in yourself which other principles you would add to those that are already on the board without even having the over, just having it as like, you know, compasses.
So quick, but the irony is that it's if you look at history, there's a great book, Steven Pinker, you know, Our Better Angels, that looks at homicide rates and rates of violent death over the last like 1,000 years. We're in an unprecedented era of peace and prosperity. There's never been anything like this. And we're all looking at our feet convinced that, you know, we're about to meet our doom. And you know, there was a great Nicholas Kristof column a few weeks ago. You know, 250,000 people leave extreme poverty every day in this world. We've never seen anything like that. It's not to say that there isn't still a lot to do and injustice isn't everywhere, but it's, you know, there are actually a lot of grounds for optimism, but it's hard to focus on.
This said, I would like to thank our two panelists and invite you to the book signing. And thank you so much for being here. So they're going to sign books. Don't go away.